the person that was on, she's just so angry at everything now, and she was just so kind of full of life at the beginning of the show.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think Karen, well, is, yeah, well, she's faced with a lot. I mean, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of, we've talked about that Karen's kind of a control freak, and when she was in control, I think life was a lot easier for her than when she thought she was in control. And this season, she's kind of confronting one of the biggest things you really kind of control, which is mortality. So, yeah, I mean, I think, I don't know if it's a straight journey there, but I think this season is particularly challenging for the character.
So, when I was seeing the introduction, and I was talking about this, the show did work for this group, is not only about crime yourself, it's also about the mystery of the unknowability of people, and what it feels like to have a complete 180 have a relationship on anything. Like, that's part of the mystery of the show, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I guess the thing that that we were looking at this season was just when you think you've got it together, that it all starts to fall apart again. I feel like the sort of unknowability of the character's life just continues to unspool, just like it unspools in everybody's life. You know, the tendency of narrative is to go towards clarity at some point. You know, I'm not saying that we're not trying to be clear, that we are, you know, every so often we do really try to clear things up, but then we feel like, you know, it gets murky, it gets murky again. It does.
That's life. I mean, I think, yeah. Like, aren't we always trying to clarify? And then you're like, I got it.
Right.
And then you pretend you don't. Yeah. And, you know, and something else happens. So, I'm laughing because it's true.
That's true. And I want to ask you this, because really the show is about, it's about the mystery of people. And in the first, especially the first episodes, Helen really thinks she knows everything. She thinks she's got things worked out with her parents, trying to keep them out of the house, although they drive her out at something crazy. And now she really faces the fact that she doesn't know anything. And then getting those control freaks out of it. It's also being that age and feeling like you're in free fall. It's a terrible thing.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
What if I just do everything Sarah does?
We rehearsed this before. We do the dance
routine. So, can you, I'm sorry to repeat the question. No, so meaning this season, yeah. Being in free fall.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, I think, again, as I said, this season she's really, no one is listening to her, and
even her shrink basically has this program,
right? And she's not listening to him either. She's not listening to anybody.
Yeah.
I mean, that's actually very interesting. That's more the problem. I mean, she's not listening to anybody. She's got an agenda of what she thinks is going to work, and she isn't really listening. And I think that causes her a lot of pain, and causes one to feel uncomfortable. If you're not paying attention to me, what other people are trying to communicate. Has a lot of panic in yourself.
Right, yeah. I mean, we talked about before that Helen is very smart as a character, and she's used to being right. And she's used to being the character that other people turn to when stuff goes wrong, to get some answers, to hold things up. And so when things start to unravel, so in some ways, you know, everybody's reaction to the affair is in some way or another to fall apart. Like every character in the show, past their day. But in some ways, Helen's day has been maybe delayed. She's had her moments for sure, but she hasn't really had her, I think she's had her nadir just because she's was the sort of most functional character potentially to begin with, so it took longer. It's fun to take those characters to that place because they really look kicking and screaming. You know, but then there's this, I think.
Fun is kind of a
super fun to write. really fun to watch.
No, I'm kidding. But yes, yeah. It's true. Like, it's like she could take it, and she could take it, and she could take it, and finally there's something that she can come up with.
And we really, we get her to a place where it's just, she can't take it.
Yeah.
And then I do think that for at least this season is like, it's actually her pathway to transformation.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree.
not saying there are limitations until we see your mom, who really is.
Right.
Yeah. And just for actually not knowing what to say, it's kind of wonderful to watch.
Yeah, I mean, and that she's a great actress. That seems different than I thought when we shot it. Because I watched it, because I haven't been watching, I don't normally like to watch myself, but I've been doing a lot of press, so I thought I should watch some of the stuff. And so that episode, in my mind, I thought Helen was being more flippant. I don't know, but it came out a lot softer, and I really liked it very much, actually.
Did you think you were playing as flippant?
Yeah, I felt like I was being more of a bitch, sort of, or had more of an attitude to her being mean, and there was more vulnerability, at least.
And we had been cutting a scene, actually, between the therapist's office and Priya.
Yeah,
the I am. Yeah. Yeah. You wanted to do it anyway. Nobody wanted to do it.
Go into the store.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I like that scene a lot.
I'm pretty sure they're going to watch you.
Oh, well.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, my thing is, yeah. I didn't want to give away to the audience. And I was telling you that today that the show would actually be my biggest movie because I was also thinking about One Night Stand, one of my biggest movies are about how a betrayal of a relationship basically ruins everything. Almost every other Mike Figgins movie is about something like this.
Right. Yeah. No, I mean he was great. He was incredibly passionate about the show and had a very clear vision coming into it, which was nice for us. Seriously, right. And it was nice for us in the fourth season, I think, because we just having somebody kind of come in and shake everything up.
And somebody doesn't think like a TV director.
It doesn't think like a TV director, right?
Except
yeah.
In like a
scene in a
hardware store.
Yeah.
That's fine.
We had this really great scene in a hardware store where she's like going to, because when you see when she walks into the scene with Priya, she's got all these red bags, and it's because she's gone to the hardware store and bought all these like earthquake kits, you know, like these what did you, and this guy is talking to her and he's like, are you from New York? And she's like, how do you know? Take herself down with like all these earthquake kits, you know. It's like, bars that like they're like 3,000 calories and they can survive like 30 days on them. It's like okay. Anyway, we ended up cutting it because it actually was a little redundant and you know it's a TV show. Yeah.
Yeah. And to get back to your original question, yes, Priya speaks, she's truly my her match and a controlling woman. And I like the way it played. I don't know, it seemed like she won.
Yeah, and we also really like the idea that like Helen, like Priya doesn't like Helen, you know, but Helen's used to being liked. You know, people like Helen. And like Priya's like, not good enough for my son, you know? And it was just, I don't know, it was a fun dynamic for her.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed watching, and that's where I'm going.
I don't know too much, but that's the thing that plays out in later episodes, the disconnect between Helen and her husband's family. But one of the things I'm going to talk about, and we see in this season, although it's been kind of dealt a little bit, is the way Grace played the part in this season. I think it's really interesting. How Helen deals.
Yeah, I think that we, you know, I mean, obviously, I think we wanted to broaden the scope of the show a little bit this season and to bring in some more characters and just kind of like take the world outside and support people. And we did it in Noah's story, and we did it in Helen's story, and even Cole's story deals with it to a certain extent. And so, people have asked, like, in interviews before that, you know, is this show trying to respond topically to what's happening in the country? And the truth is, yes and no. Like, we're not trying to be reactionary and sort of catch up, but we are trying to take our characters through their lives as real people in this real world. And so these characters are basically coming up against, like, you know, the kids Muslim, and he has been Muslim from the very beginning, never really addressed it. But it would be part of their lives. So he's actually half on the path. So it's got a super complicated backstory. But I guess we felt that this particular season was going to be more about the characters dealing with themselves and having to basically like take accountability for themselves and less about them necessarily like being really intense. mean, there's plenty of entanglement in this season, but it's really about, like, all the characters basically having to look at themselves in some sort of mirror and say, like, you know, what are my prejudices, what are my biases, how have I been contributing to a dynamic that I'm, you know, saying is victimizing me and all that stuff. So, yeah, I don't know. It was,
yeah, and what am I ignorant of?
Right.
But, I mean, that's sort of the thing that happens with Hunter. But it's, he's like, do you understand that what you don't even know anything how you're saying right now? You know, and that's a lot to realize ignorance is, you know.
Yeah, it's not fun.
It's not fun at all. And I mean, like, it's him, like, you know, she criticizes his parents, and he's like, you have no clue.
Oh, that's actually a great scene.
Yeah, it's like, you know what? These people came, you know, they're immigrants and what they gave up for me, and you've never had to give up any sacrifice, anything for your children. So it's really
important for a body individual.
Yeah.
You're right.
So, and also, I was just afraid, I don't know how much I'll have to say about that.
Yeah.
But yes, I think her, that's her ignorance of the future. And she gets it.
Yeah, and if that happens with Noah, that happens with
Cole.
Yeah, it's actually, it's for whatever reason, talking about Cole.
I thought it was interesting that the show, because it's often to me felt like almost like John Cheever's short stories. It feels like it's taken a different turn this year, where those kind of things are talking about self-involvement. And this is about how dangerous that kind of self-involvement is, about just looking at that immediate world in the house. And I always thought Talon Green's quite really great in the house. You think about her in Brooklyn and how she basically controlled that place and how she knew where everything is and how to make the kids moving. And being in LA, she's dislocated because she doesn't have that. And also, she's forced to, as you're saying, examine how kind of self-involved she is. That's going to be really interesting view of life.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I don't think she's examining it for the first half of this season. I think she's not, which is the problem. Which was actually difficult for me to play because there's a lot of decisions that Alan makes that I didn't.
There are more
that I would not make.
Yeah.
And I would say, Sarah, I would never do that.
Yeah.
And Sarah would say, well, you're not Helen.
So I would do it. Certain people have done it.
Well, please give us an example of this. Because I was wondering that whole thing. It shocked me how I'm talking about her son basically and blaming her ex-husband for him being gay. Didn't sound to me like how.
Oh, I swear to God. I love when scene. Actually, I guess I like it. I should watch them all. When she says, I'm afraid he's going to think it's your fault. And he says, why? And she says, because it is. And he says, what? And she says, I didn't say that. Like, immediately she says, I didn't say that. Which is, to me, the whole show. Like, it's almost this kind of tiny wheel dwindling down of course she just said it.
Right.
But in her, she knows she said it, but she's saying she didn't say it.
She said it. I was actually wondering about that. To that point, she didn't hear herself say it.
I'm not sure, but I think it's very real. I've done that. And you say in an argument, I didn't say that. You may have. I don't know. Maybe you didn't. But I thought it was that it was kind of naked. Her judgment, yes, about her son's, you know, sexual preference.
I think when you really boil it down, that most people's thinking is like somewhat disordered. I mean, maybe not yours. But I do think that actually, like, the, you know, the rationale that we give to, like, decisions, I'm really fascinated with this, about how we look at the decisions we've made, and then we basically make up a narrative, this is very much what the show's about, we make up a narrative sort of later to justify the decisions that we've made, and we can give you, like, a really clear account for why, but the truth is, in the moment, like 50% true, you know, maybe like 10% that narrative that you come up with later is actually what you were thinking at that moment, right? And a lot of our thinking is like, you know, for lack of a better word, like really primal and damaged, and you know, we have these knee-jerk reactions to things that are quite historical, and then we do something, and then we try to put it on the other person, but it really has a lot to do with our father, you know, and so I think like that's a little bit of a window of what you're seeing in that particular moment.
It's
that,
like an instantaneous rationalization almost.
Yeah, I mean, Alan's just basically angry. Noah. Like, she's just furious at Noah. Still. And she doesn't want to still be furious at Noah because it's been a long time. And, like, you know, theoretically everything should be okay. She's moved on and blah, blah, blah. And so, like, but then something happens that, you know, that destabilizes her sort of, but not even. But basically she uses it as, like, a flashpoint to get at Noah. And it's really irrational. And even I think she knows it's irrational at the moment. It's, like, it's not, which is, like, that's not what I said. It's, like, but she's actually saying there's, like, that's not what I mean. Like, I'm not even really talking about trying to be gay or not. I'm talking about something else right now. So, yeah, for some reason we try to go to those, like, weird places.
And, that's happened a few times in the show. Yeah. And that moment made me think about what the show is about, which is obviously from the point of view, but the point of view actually changing in the scenes. We give the ship a smile from the point of view. She's already recreating her narrative.
Right.
In a big conversation.
She's rewriting
it. As she's doing it.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a later scene in the fourth episode, in the third episode, where she makes the choice, but I think Maura was like, "That's I could never make that choice."
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and my argument was like, I might make that choice though, so can we just go with it? And then I don't know what else.
But this is a question, because what season now? We've just been talking about this, but you know, at this point, you have ownership of the character. You've been with for a while. You've been giving this a lot of love. You have a lot of ideas about who she is and what she wouldn't do. So to come to this situation suddenly, well, I don't know if I approve of her doing this. How do you rationalize acting that, making an acting choice?
I mean, I don't actually really think I have approval, or necessarily should. I mean, the character is a character because of Sarah and the writers, and they really do respect and understand that, so I like to try to help, or I like to collaborate, or say my thoughts. But I don't think I don't feel I need to approve of anything. I think there's a bigger picture that Sarah has, and the other writers have, all of you guys, that I don't necessarily have. And I was saying the other day when we were doing press, who said?
When did it become
your character?
Chase.
The writer said the actor was like, my character would never do this. And David Chase said, well, when did it become your character? Because it does start with the writer, you know. And I'm quite respectful of that and appreciative of that. So it's hard sometimes. I mean, it's not often that we disagree.
No, it's not, sometimes we have a really good collaboration going.
Yeah.
We'll get into a scene and like it won't, for whatever reason, it'll be overwritten or it's not quite working. We're both able to say, like, this isn't quite working.
Yeah.
And then we've got to turn to where Maura will be like, what are you looking for? Like, what are we trying to do here with the scene? You know, and then I'll be like, I don't know, I think I want this. And then she'll be like, okay, well, what if we tried this? You know, and that's what you want. I mean, that's what you want in any kind of creative collaboration. That's basically both minds are working towards the same agenda.
And also, I wouldn't underestimate fear in terms of, for me as an actor, there are... It's amusing how this used to be light. I mean, I think it's funny. So there are, like, you know, whatever. But, like, these choices that the character makes, it's, you know, there's... It's fearful sometimes as an actor to... It's not that you don't ever want to be the bad guy or you don't ever want to be a character actor, but, it's fearful sometimes to have to act things that you really don't... that's scary. And so I think that went into a lot of that. There was a lot of resistance because the whole thing's carried me into it. And I have to understand that that's that, and that's not art. That's fine.
But I think that's process, too. That's,
yeah.
You know, it's a process of writing, too. It's like, go towards what you're writing.
Yeah.
Write
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Write, you know, try to get away from the conflict, right towards the
law. I was kind of trying to
what I think is interesting, especially from like the third season to now, is just seeing you talking about Helen wanting to be elected. Helen exercises so much control. She's so willful and smart that she almost a step ahead of people.
She is.
And watching that, that's been a really incremental thing that's happened in through the third season to now. We've seen this happen step by step. And the fury comes out with Noah and with Trent. These two guys who should be authority figures in their lives aren't that anymore. And that frustration, I think, is a
it's fun. I mean, it's really, the shrimp stuff is really well written. It's so much fun.
He was great.
And there are long scenes, but they didn't feel so long. Like, and it's funny to me that Helen is a shrink that she she's like, catch up! Everyone needs to catch up. Which is sometimes true in life. People do need to catch up.
You saw
that
scene, right?
Yeah, I watched one in the movie.
Because I thought that seemed like a master class in acting as well. They're just watching Maura on that couch, like, okay, embarrassed right now, but like, she just does it as an actor. It's so incredible to watch, you know, from behind the camera, and then you get into the cutting room, and it's really rare that you get into the cutting room and there's nothing you want to change in a scene. Like, you know, like, we got into the cutting room, we looked at that scene, and I was like, well, that's done. I mean, like, I don't know what to do with that scene. That scene is perfect.
She didn't know she's an arborist.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was like, get that arborist back in there. And she just, like, it really was, like, watching her, like, her comic timing is absurdly good, and we don't, you know, we're not a funny show all the time, so she doesn't always get to employ it, but when she does, it's a little bit like, well, just like watch, sit back and just watch the video.
Well, I want to tell people a little bit about this other episode, because she does something that's not necessarily going to hide to say that in the scene with Shrine. We talk about kids, I don't give that away, but she says no, and she goes, well, yes. Remember when we said, well, what are you bowing for?
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, again, just that she, that kind of will control you, almost with the thing of Helen being more the writer than no, because she's so precise with mine.
Oh, that's so interesting.
What if she's writing all the novels? Like, she's been ghostwriting the whole time.
I can't even buy her now.
And that to me is always, like, if there's anything that's true about human existence, it seems to me that it really is like, when we think we understand something, we don't understand it yet. You know, it's a little bit like two steps forward, three steps back. You know, and there's this sort of push and pull in life, and then eventually the like intellectual realization does become an emotional understanding, which is why I think we, you know, that whole scan of your body thing at the beginning, which is where the shrink is so, we're using him as comic relief, but you, I think you'll see over the course of the season that it really does become like pretty thematic for Helen, this idea of getting out of her head and getting out of her intellectual, you know, sort of marionette style of life and just letting herself live, you know, and kind of go into something more like emotional and present, and that being a kind of a key towards maybe getting to the place that she wants to get to in the beginning.
One of the things in the last question I could ask, sorry, Maura, is I'm asking about Helen's this thing called weakness. She doesn't like weakness at all, and that we see it more in this season as things are really getting out of control. That it remains like initially it's weak, because not making a decision, but she responded to that. And I just wonder if you had a take on that, because I think it's really interesting. You see her sort of, she looks so called north, we never had her there, and she just has to walk around. But this is
interesting. It's interesting. I don't know if I've consciously thought about that, but my immediate answer would be that it's her mother, right? Like, I feel like we haven't seen, and her father, I mean, we haven't seen her parents in a while,
yeah.
But I would say that makes sense to me, even though I don't know that there are a choice any on these. But clearly, she had these parents that raised her with these very stringent, you know, rules about what you're supposed to look like and how you're supposed to present.
They were both really narcissistic.
And both very narcissistic. But how does that have to do with non-humanness?
Because I feel like the narcissistic parent wants the child to be perfect, and if the child's not perfect, it's such
rejected.
It's the critical response that it
right.
is. This idea that like, if I'm weak, I'm not loved.
So then that's really very, I mean, that I didn't know that, but I mean, so that makes sense. But I would basically think it's that her upbringing.
For me, the first move is from the marriage, seeing her know her parents, and just seeing how he is versus her. Just sort of, she's her not like the way that he acts with her parents.
And she doesn't stand up for him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. I really like that about the character. She's really wrestling with that.
I'm sorry. It's one of yours. Wrestling with that in this season.
Yeah. And we have talked a lot about, you know, the season is ostensibly about her relationship with Vic, but in a lot of ways it becomes about her relationship with Noah. You know, it's a thing where like the next really you're sort of playing out the drama of the previous relationship and the next relationship, and then in some ways actually heals the drama of the previous relationship. Another weird thing that we tend to do, but I do think that actually this idea that like that she's a character that doesn't like weakness is really on the nose, and I don't know that we've ever talked about it, but I think it's absolutely accurate. And I think that like Noah and Helen got together when they were really young, and for him, like